We found that indeed iron was the main component, but also there was 12% nickel and the traces of cobalt, which are very typical of meteorites from the solar system. So it was easy to settle an archaeological dispute which was going on for a long time.
Welcome to Chelonia Podcast, a podcast about the use of scientific discoveries and technology applications. We provide the best information on projects participated by Chelonia and many more. My name is Gabriella Bernardi, I'm a science journalist, and in today's episode of the second season, we talk about archaeophysics, X-ray and Tutankhamun's world with the Professor Francesco Porcelli, Politecnico di Torino, Italy. Nice to meet you, and would you please briefly introduce yourself?
Yes, good morning. My name is Francesco Porcelli. I am a full professor of physics at the Politecnico di Torino in Italy. My main line of research is actually plasma physics. But I have recently also started to work in the field of archaeophysics. This was occasioned by the fact that I spent 8 years in Egypt serving as a scientific attaché at the Embassy of Italy in Cairo.
And now, Professor, what is archaeophysics?
Archaeophysics is basically physics applied to cultural heritage and archaeology. It is a field that has been around for many years. A typical example is the dating of cultural heritage artifacts using, for instance, carbon radioactive decay. But of course, in recent years, this field has developed a lot because of important progress in scientific instrumentations. If I can make just one example, just to give an idea of what archaeophysics can do, very recently, using cosmic rays or particles produced by cosmic rays called muons, has been possible to make a muon radiography of the Khufu's pyramid in Egypt, and this has revealed the existence of a very large void, possibly a new corridor and a new chamber, and I think this may become one of the most important archaeological discoveries of the century.
Amazing. But Professor Porcelli was part of the team that proved the meteoritic origin of the iron blade of Tutankhamun's world based on X-ray measurements. Would you please tell us about this in detail?
Sure. We are talking about Tutankhamun's iron dagger, which was found wrapped inside the mummy of Tutankhamun, so in a very, very prominent position, as if this was one of the most important jewels that the boy king Tutankhamun was bringing with himself to the afterlife. In fact, there were two daggers. One was made of iron, and as I said, was in a very prominent position inside the mummy. The other one was made of gold and was on the side. The point is that at the time of Tutankhamun in ancient Egypt, iron was much more precious than gold, simply because the ancient Egyptians had not found iron ores, while gold was relatively abundant. In addition, you have to consider that the ancient Egyptians believed that the sky vault was made of iron, and they were aware of meteorites which were coming from the sky, and of course the sky in Egyptian religion had a very important role. So iron was very important.
Very, very interesting. And now we are at the end of this podcast, but do you expect further developments for this technique?
Yes, let me if I have time.
Yes, absolutely.
Let me explain what we did, and then you will understand what can be done with the technique that we used to establish the meteoritic origin of Tutankhamun's iron dagger. There was a debate whether the iron in Tutankhamun's dagger was manufactured by ancient Egyptians, but they only knew meteoritic iron, or whether it was a gift from Anatolia, where iron metallurgy had been developed already at the time of Tutankhamun. So there was a debate, and as a physicist, I thought, well, the way to settle the debate is to measure the elemental composition of the iron. And you can do that with an instrument called X-ray fluorescence spectrometer, which is a relatively simple instrument. You can carry it in a suitcase, and you can mount it on a tripod. And this instrument sends a beam of X-rays towards the object, and then it detects the reflected signal. It's totally non-invasive. The beam is low energy, so it's not dangerous. And in this way, you can find what the iron dagger is made of. And we found, when I say we, is a collaboration between the Politecnico di Torino, Politecnico di Milano, and the meteorite experts from the University of Pisa. We found that indeed iron was the main component, but also there was 12% nickel and the traces of cobalt, which are very typical of meteorites from the solar system. So it was easy to settle an archaeological dispute which was going on for a long time. Now you can imagine that this type of technique can be used it is being used in a variety of circumstances. So yes, I do expect a lot of development in the use of X-ray fluorescence to cultural heritage.
Amazing, Professor. Thank you. Thank you so much for this interesting interview. And thanks our listeners. If you have any questions about today's podcast, you can get in touch on Chelonia Twitter, and feel free to subscribe to chelonia.swiss website and be part of the community. In the meantime, stay tuned for our next interview. Thank you again, Professor.
Thank you.